Good morning. Welcome to Lighthouse Baptist. Would you stand with me and we'll sing No Other Name? No other name but the name of Jesus, the name we celebrate this Christmas. No other name.
No other name but the name of Jesus. No other name but the name of the Lord. No other name but the name of Jesus is worthy of honor. And worthy of honor, and worthy of power, and all praise.
His name is exalted.
His name is exalted far above the earth. His name is high above the heavens. His name is exalted.
Wonderful singing this morning. Can we lift up this carol? Hark the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King on that first.
Hark the herald angels sing. Glory to the newborn King. Peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconciled. Joyful on me.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
How you doing? What a beautiful day, is it not? I mean, it doesn't feel like almost getting into January, does it? I mean, it seems like it's like April. I like it. I'll take it. It's good. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much for your goodness to us. And Lord, thank you for such a beautiful day here in the middle of December, mid-40s. And we thank you for that. And Lord, we thank you for these that you allowed to be here this morning. Many aren't allowed to be here or able to be here. And I pray that you'll meet with them this morning as well, whether they're watching at home now or whether they'll watch the video later. I pray that you'll speak to their hearts as well. We thank you, Lord, for coming to this earth to save us. What a wonderful thing to know we're on our way to heaven, that our sins have been forgiven. What a blessing. Speak to our hearts. Be with the children downstairs. Speak to their young hearts as well. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Be seated.
O beautiful star of Bethlehem, shining afar. Can we lift up this song on that first?
O beautiful star of Bethlehem, shining afar through shadows dim, giving the place where Jesus lay. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawn. Oh, give us thy light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Oh, beautiful star, the hope of light, guiding the pilgrim through the night, over the mountain till the break of dawn. And into the light of perfect day, it will give out a lovely ray. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on.
Star of Bethlehem, star of Bethlehem, shine upon us until the glory dawn.
Oh, give us thy light to light the way into the land of perfect day. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on.
We have one last song, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. Come thou long.
Come thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. From our fears and sins release us. Let us find our rest in thee, Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing.
Born thy people.
To deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom bring. By thine own eternal spirit,
Well, good morning again. Hope you had a wonderful, wonderful week. It sure has been nice. Had a little bit of snow this week, but it melted just as fast as it fell. And of course, we're smack dab in the middle of what we call the Christmas holiday. And of course, we want to remind ourselves over and over again the reason for the season. We're going to look at some attributes this morning of Christmas. You know, I mentioned last Sunday when we started this little mini-series about what Christmas was to me as a little boy. And honestly, it didn't have anything to do with Jesus. Didn't have anything to do with God. All it had to do was Christmas presents and different things like that. And then I mentioned last week, my dad got saved. And we started going to church. I mean, we never went to church. Once in a blue moon, I'd go to the Holiness Church with my grandma. And if you've never been to a Holiness Church, man, you're missing out. But I'd go to the Holiness Church with my grandma once in a while. But other than that, we just didn't do church. We didn't go to church. We didn't talk about God. We didn't think about God. As a matter of fact, God wasn't even in our thoughts. But hey, I'm so glad for this. We are in God's thoughts. And of course, that's why God sent his son. After my dad got saved, we started going to church. And you know, Christmas started taking on a new meaning. I mean, I know Luke chapter 2 inside and out now. But before salvation, before we started going to church, I never knew anything about Luke chapter number 2. You know, I would see the little nativity scenes, and of course I knew that little baby was Jesus. And I did know these things, but I didn't know, you know. And sometimes you can know without knowing, you know. And Paul said that in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. He said, that I may what? Know him and the power of his resurrection. So this morning we're going to talk about God. We're going to talk about knowing God. And I hope you know God. Not just that there is a God. The Bible says the devils also know. The devils believe and tremble. But let's look at Luke chapter number 2 this morning. We're going to start reading verse number 8. The Bible says, and there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field. They lived there. They lived there among the animals. It wasn't an easy life. And that's what they did. What were they doing? Keeping watch over their flock by night. Look what it says in verse 9. And lo, the angel. I mean, an angel showed up. Can you imagine that? The dark of the night. I mean, the sky was lit up by this angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. You know, even the toughest people in this earth, when they see God, and when they stand before God, guess what? They're going to be sore afraid. And we can deny him, we can mock him, we can be in denial about all those things. But here we have those shepherds there, and they weren't religious men, believe me. They weren't religious people. But when they saw this angel, they didn't see God, mind you. They saw an angel, and the Bible says they were sore afraid. And I like the grace of God. Look what God says here. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you, look at this here, good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. Now, it's not a big part of the message. As a matter of fact, it's not part of the message, but I want you to get a picture in your mind about the time that this was going on. It was a dark time. I mean, the Roman government was pretty ruthless. And of course, they were running everything. They had some pretty nasty prisons. They had some pretty strict rules about, as far as taxes, as far as all different kinds of things. And they had the worst execution style, one of the worst ever known to man, called the crucifixion. And they would crucify people. And so this was a pretty dark time, a pretty dreary time. But here this angel says, behold, I bring you what? Good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. In verse 11, for unto you is born this day in the city of David, look at this here, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts. Now, I don't know how big this multitude was, but there was a whole group now of angels. And that, what were they doing? They were praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the word of God. We thank you that we can open it. We thank you that it can enlighten us and help us. And Lord, we pray that that's what will happen this morning. We pray that we'll be enlightened and encouraged by your word this morning. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, here we have what we call the first Christmas. Now, I mentioned, of course, Christmas is not a Bible word, okay? But it's just what we call the birth of our Savior. I mean, was Jesus born on December 25th? I highly doubt it, okay? And we're not going to get into all that this morning, but we're talking about the time of celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Of course, during a dark time. And of course, today, we're living in a dark time. I mean, it may not be like it was back in the Bible days with these very visible Roman soldiers and all these type of things, but who knows where we're heading, you know what I'm saying? But we're living in this dark time now. And you know what? That light that came into this world 2,000 years ago was still very, very real. And we're going to talk about and be reminded about this morning the attributes of Christmas, because I think we need to be reminded of them over and over again, because even as Christians, we can get caught up in the hoopla. We can get caught up in in the midst of this virus and even in the midst of this COVID-19 and everything. We can still get our minds off of the reason for the season. And so this morning we're going to look at some attributes, looking at these verses and using these verses of things that we need to be reminded of about Christmas. Here's the first thought this morning. Let's look at verse number 10, please. The Bible says, and the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you what? Good tidings of great joy, which shall be to what? To all people. And so the first thought this morning is this. Christmas is a time of good tidings. The angel said this. Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings. This is actually talking about good news. This is actually talking about evangelizing. It's talking about the Savior being born. And he says, hey, I bring you good tidings. So the angel came with a message of good tidings, with a message of good news. Now, keep in mind, these shepherds didn't hear a lot of good news. They were kind of like social outcasts, kind of like misfits. Here they were out there. They didn't communicate with people much. Their life was with the animals, with the sheep. And you know what? That angel showed up that night and he said, hey, I got some good tidings for you. I have some good news for you. And folks, let's not forget the good news. The good news. I was really thinking about this a lot yesterday and about how all of us, we have to be careful. We're in this pit of despair. I made a Facebook post about it, just about being a prisoner in our own minds and just being stuck in a dark and dreary place. And hey, I don't know about you, but I've been stuck there before. How about you? And man, I don't want to be stuck there. I don't want to be stuck in a dreary place. And we need to be reminded this morning that we still have those good tidings that were mentioned some 2,000 years ago. It was a message of good tidings. And ultimately, it was this. It was a message of hope. A message of hope. You know, the politicians talk a lot about hope, and I specifically remember Bill Clinton being elected, and if I'm not if I'm not mistaken, Bill Clinton was born or brought up in a town called Hope, Arkansas. How convenient for a politician to be born or raised, I forget which it was, I think it was both, frankly, that being born and raised in a little town in Arkansas called Hope. And you know, Bill Clinton promised a lot of hope, you know. And the next one promised a lot of hope, and the next one, and they keep promising hope. But listen, they can't give the hope that God can give. And this hope that was mentioned 2,000 years ago is still the hope that we have today. It's a message of hope. Now keep in mind, the first people to hear this message, social outcasts, uneducated, poor. You know, on a little side note here, you know these shepherds raised a lot of sheep for the temple. And you know, truth be told, they weren't even themselves welcome in the temple. Think about that. Man, these folks needed hope. And you know, I'm so glad that God decided to send that first message of hope to a bunch of lowly people. He could have announced it to the wealthy. He could have announced it to kings. He could have announced it to a lot of people. But you know what God chose? To announce this message of hope to the lowly. And boy, I don't know about you, but that's encouraging to me. You know, that Jesus said one time, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich man to enter into heaven. You know, the rich, they don't have any need for Jesus. Jesus spent all kinds of time with people in need. As a matter of fact, he got criticized for it and got beat up for it and different things. But that's what the Lord did. And you know, this message, these good tidings, is a message of hope. Now, let me encourage you this morning. This message of hope has not changed. Has not changed. Jesus still loves the unlovable. Jesus still loves the lowly. He still loves sinners. You know, you think about some of that crowd that ran with Jesus. You think about those fishermen where Jesus says, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. The Bible said that they were unlearned and ignorant. We know Peter was vulgar and he was hot-tempered. And we know Mary Magdalene, who was a prominent lady in the circle of Jesus. I mean, here we have a demon-possessed woman that had a very, very bad, bad past. But guess what? Jesus, the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ gave her hope. Gave Peter hope. How about Saul of Tarsus? Very religious, but lost. Jesus came to give hope to the religious. How many of you, I mentioned my testimony, I wasn't religious at all. My family wasn't religious at all. Hey, how many of you in here this morning, I'm just curious, you were like Cornelius in Acts chapter number 10. You were pretty religious, but you were lost and on your way to hell. How many of you like that this morning? Not a whole lot, but quite a few. Jesus gives hope to the religious law, like Cornelius. Don't study it now, but boy, if you're ever curious about religious people, and how could that person possibly not be on their way to heaven? Well, you look at Acts chapter number 10 and study the life of Cornelius, and you'll see that he was a great person. He gave alms to the people. He prayed to God always. He did all these things, but there was a problem. He had no hope. There was a problem. He was lost, and he was on his way to hell. So Christmas is about good tidings. Christmas is about good news. It's about hope. How about this? It's about a fresh start. It's about a fresh start. As I look around this room, I know many of your testimonies. And the day you got saved, guess what? God gave you a fresh start. He gave your life a fresh start. He gave your marriage a fresh start. And many of you, he gave your finances a fresh start. He gave your whole life. Think about that. That good news. Those good tidings. Hey, you're about ready to have a fresh start. Boy, I like a fresh start. And that's going to be a big part of our theme, by the way, letting the cat out of the bag. That's going to be a big part of our theme going into 2021. Just a fresh start. What else is Christmas doing? Christmas is a time for good tidings. Christmas is a time for giving. You know, being a preacher, I had to get to that, right? That it's a time of giving. And I'm not talking necessarily about dollars and cents, although that's part of it. Jesus said, where your treasure is, there will what? There will your heart be also. But look at chapter number 2, verse 11. It says, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is what? Which is Christ the Lord. Hey, think about this. God gave to man. God gave to us his Son. God in the flesh. You know, one of the Christmas words that we mention this time of year is Emmanuel. One of the prophecies about the Lord, you're going to call his name Emmanuel, which is being interpreted what? God with us. God with us. John 1:1, we're just going to look at a couple of scriptures about that. How Jesus was, in fact, God in the flesh. In the beginning was the Word. Talking about Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word, what? Was God. Verse 2 says, the same was in the beginning with God. And if we jump down to verse 14, you'll see that one on the screen there. Jump down to verse 14, it says, and the Word was made what? Flesh. I don't know about you, Ethan, but I have a hard time thinking about that. You're familiar with the human body. We're going to have you come up and teach us some anatomy. But think about that human body. Jesus, God, the Word was made flesh. Why? Because you can't kill God. But you can kill flesh. So Jesus had to become flesh. Think about that. He bled like we bleed. He was thirsty like we thirst. He was hungry. You know, you look at Matthew chapter 4, and we see Jesus fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, and the Bible says that he was weak. The devil showed up, tempting him with things. And that's what the devil does, by the way. We get down a little bit, and I'm telling you what, just like a shark smells blood in the water, and I don't understand that either. But I've watched the little Shark Week shows, and I've seen the National Geographic things, and then how a shark can smell blood for I don't know how many miles through the water. Smell that blood. Boy, that's just what the devil smells. He smells that. And be sober, be vigilant. For your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, and that lion can smell blood too. for miles. They can smell that blood. And man, they just want to pounce. You know, this morning I was driving to the Hayton, and I saw something I haven't seen a lot. And I don't like to see it, but I saw a hawk. And it just caught a bird. And I couldn't really tell what bird it was. But I saw the little, I just caught it, caught movement. And then I saw that hawk start to fly away and that bird hanging. And I thought, man, that's a bad day for that bird, you know. But I thought, wow, here was that little bird just minding its own business, probably picking some seeds and just enjoying a beautiful day. And little did he know, perched up on a branch over there was a hawk watching. You know, we're under the same kind of surveillance. And the devil's just waiting to pounce on us. Be sober, clear thinking. Be sober. Be vigilant. Because that adversary, that devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Jesus was at a weak moment and hungry, and the devil showed up, and Jesus had that flesh, you know. He was weak, he was hungry. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Think about that for a minute. He left heaven's throne. He came down to this old sin-cursed earth and walked among us and dwelt among us. It says here, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. God gave to man. What did he give man? He gave his only begotten Son. He gave his Son. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have what? Everlasting life. Christmas is a time of giving. The time when we realize, hey, you know what? God gave his most precious, precious gift. The gift of his only Son. You know, in my flesh, I don't have a hard time giving away my leftovers. No. You ever take things to the Salvation Army over there by Kohl's? How many of you have been to the Salvation Army over by Kohl's? Have you ever driven around the back there? Have you ever looked in that room? Oh, my goodness. I wouldn't want to work there. Going through, I mean, junk. I mean, much of the time we take our junk there, and I think, man, maybe we should just throw it away. No, somebody could use this. We'll take it down to Salvation Army. And I walk in there and think, whoa. People are not prone to give their best. Before we get too high and mighty, we need to realize about ourselves, we're not too prone to give our best. We don't mind giving our unusables, things we don't no longer have need for. And if we're not careful, that thought, that feeling, that selfishness will carry over into God. Get to the point where we just give God our crumbs. I don't know how many times I've heard people say to me, preacher, I'll be there if I have time, or if nothing comes up, I'll be there. Or if I can afford it, you know, I'll give towards the building or whatever. You know, we're so used to just giving our excess or our leftovers, but that's not what Christmas is about. God gave his best to us. And that's what stewardship is all about. You know, we have three things that we're supposed to be good stewards of, and if I can remember them, just popping into my head. Our time, our talents, and our treasures. Think about those wise men. They didn't bring their leftovers. They brought treasures. And they brought these gifts. Let's look at it. Matthew 2:11. You probably know the scripture pretty well. Matthew 2:11. And when they were coming to the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshiped him. These wise men. Now, on a side note, I want you to understand it was a young child, and they weren't in a house. They weren't in a manger, and it wasn't a little baby anymore. Okay? And it never says anywhere that there was three of them. I don't know how many wise men there were, but I do know there were three gifts. There were three gifts that were brought: gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And myrrh was used specifically for burying people. All these three gifts, very significant. I preached a message in years gone past, a Christmas message about these three gifts. And it's interesting when you study these three gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh, but they're given to a king. That little boy in the house, they brought these treasures from a long ways away. And we call them wise men. Have you ever seen the bumper sticker, wise men? Still, what? Seek him. Wise men still seek him. Can I add something to that? Wise men still give of their best. And these aren't in the notes. But I thank the Lord that I was raised. After my dad got saved, he always had a mentality of giving the Lord his best. And boy, let me tell you something. Growing up, I hated it. I got angry at it. Why doesn't anybody else cut the grass? Why is it always us? Why is it always us changing a transmission on a bus or fixing the brakes? Why is it always us? Why is it always us painting and fixing up and... Why is it always us? And you know what? My dad, this is God's honest truth. He never said anything like this. Well, that's because those people are selfish, rotten. That's because those people, that's because we're better than them. Or anything along those lines, nothing negative. Every time without fail, he said, Butch, don't worry about what other people do. We're doing this for the Lord. That made me even madder. Hey, I'm telling you the truth. It did. Because I thought that's ridiculous. That's a stupid answer. Not the answer I was wanting. I was wanting the answer just like you want. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, people. Yeah, blah, blah, blah. But no. Man, and I don't know of anybody in this world more blessed than my dad. That's a God's honest truth. Across the board. And you know what? I'm pretty blessed too. And guess what? You're pretty blessed too. Folks, let me tell you, it's not popular to preach it this morning, but God deserves our best. God does not just deserve our leftovers, our hand-me-downs, where we just pull into the Salvation Army and just throw our junk out along with everybody else's junk. I first became pastor here 20 years ago in a few months. And first thing I did, of course, you walk all through the buildings, and I walked downstairs, and let me tell you something, it was full of junk. Some of you'll remember. I mean, I kid you not, there were washers down there, dryers, refrigerators, stoves. It was everything that people gave to the church over the years. that they didn't want anymore. And we got dumpsters, big ones, and started throwing out all the junk that people gave to the church. Junk. Let me tell you something, folks. God deserves more than our leftovers. Even during the pandemic, God deserves more than our junk. Even during a pandemic, do you agree with me? He does. Men should give to God. But let me tell you what he really wants. Oh, I don't want to go to that church. All they want is your money. You know? Oh, no, he wants more than that. Let's be real honest. He wants more than that. He wants you. Paul said, you are bought with Christ. Therefore, we're supposed to glorify God in our minds and our bodies with everything, which are what? Which are God. Greatest thing we'll ever do is give God ourselves. And that's what God wants. He wants us to bring of ourselves to the Lord. Let's look at a couple scriptures about that. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 4. 2 Corinthians 8, verse 4. Praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift. Of course, Paul was on the road. He was a missionary, and churches gave him gifts, and people gave him gifts. Praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift. And take upon us the fellowship of ministering to the saints. And that's what they did. They took these monies, and we know that Paul was a tent maker as well. That he traveled, and a big part of his ministry was getting gifts, and so that they could do what? It says here, minister to the saints. Verse 5. And this they did. Talk about people giving. And this they did, not as we hoped. Hey, he wasn't complaining here. He was being positive. He said, not a minimum, but first, look at this here. They gave of their own selves to the Lord and unto us. And unto us by the will of God. And that's what we're supposed to do. God and us. God and people. God and man. And that's what Paul's life was. He said that these people, they were willing first to give of themselves. Let me ask you, are you still willing to do that? Sometimes we think we become exempt from it because of frustration. We get angry, and therefore we think, I'm not given anymore. Preachers would joke about it over the years, and about how one of the ways you know a person's getting disgruntled, the first thing they quit doing is what? Tithing. Giving. I'm not giving the church my hard-earned money anymore because I don't like what they're doing. I don't like what they're preaching. I don't like that. So I'm going to give my money. I'm going to do something else with my money. That goes back to that verse where our treasure is. There will our heart be also. But we'll blame the church or the people, or we'll blame a lot of reasons why we no longer give of ourselves. Just like my dad, and I got to be honest with you, we had this dinky little church, and it was full of problems all the time. I mean, my first 3 years in the ministry, I worked for three different pastors. 3 years, three different men. Let me tell you, they didn't leave for another church just because whatever. It was a bad situation. Sin. And let me tell you something. I got angry at God. I got bitter at God. I said, you know what? I didn't go to school for this. I didn't give my life for this. And I'm telling you what, I'm done. And I've told you this before. Maybe you're sick of hearing it. I'm sorry. But God says, you quit on me, you're going to lose it all. I mean, it was just like I was told audibly. I mean, you're going to lose everything. You're going to regret it. And I got even angrier. I felt trapped. Maybe you're here this morning, you feel trapped. Trapped in church, trapped. Boy, that's not how God wants us to be. That's a bad place to be. I've been there. I wish I could tell you that's the only time I felt that way. It's not. We feel trapped. But let me tell you something. That's the devil. He wants us to feel trapped. He wants us to quit. He wants us to quit giving of ourselves. And here's the ultimate reason. It's not so the church will suffer and, you know, have to really make cuts and the building will start falling apart. That's part of it, but here's the real reason. Because you'll snuff out another light. And all around us, the devil's blowing out another one. And right now, this pandemic, man, I'm telling you what, it's tough. I'm not here whining. I'm just telling you the truth. And I mean, there's a lot of lights going out. The darkness is being compounded. And of course, we know the Bible says that in the last days, perilous times will come. And what's the very first attribute? Men will be lovers of their own selves. They start putting themselves up here. Well, that's a bad thing to do, which is the opposite of giving of ourselves. And so Christmas is a time for giving. Man, I got to move along. Christmas is a time for grace. Christmas is a time for grace. Think about the grace of God that showed up that night to those pitiful, poor shepherds. They didn't deserve to be the one. God could have showed up to some, you know, faithful servants of God. You know what I'm saying? And I already mentioned kings and important people. God could have showed up there, but he didn't. He showed up to a group of nobodies. Let me tell you something. That's the grace of God. Christmas is about grace. Not just any grace, but amazing grace. Let's look at the verse again, verse 11. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, what? A Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Notice how he said, for unto you, shepherds. For unto you, you're included in this. For unto you is born this day in the city of David, a Savior. Folks, let me tell you this. We are the reason for the season. We are. Jesus came to save just a little boy. You know, this last week, I celebrated 46 years of being saved. 46 years ago this week, as an 11-year-old boy, I can't remember what side I was sitting on, either where about John is or Scott. I walked down the aisle. They took me in a little room. I knew about it all already. I'd been in church for a while. And I got saved December the 8th, 1974. For unto you is born. I wasn't going to do this, but I feel led. Would you raise your hand? I'll call on you. Tell me the day you got saved, the day you accepted God's grace. Joe. December the 7th, Pearl Harbor Day, just last week, just like me. Wow. Praise the Lord. October 12th, 2000. Praise the Lord. Nathan. Amen. Got God's grace. Praise the Lord. Yes. For unto you is born. Go. Praise the Lord. What a day. Experiencing God's grace, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And we know grace. I mean, you've heard definitions of it over the years. What is grace? God's unmerited, undeserved favor, right? If we use the acrostic, G-R-A-C-E, God's riches at what? Christ's expense. I've heard this. Grace is not getting what you deserve. I deserve hell. You deserve hell. The Bible says in Romans chapter 6, the wages of sin is what? Revelation 21:8, not on the screen. But Revelation 21:8 gives a list of people. The fearful and unbelieving, abominable, whoremongers, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. Wow. Christmas is about God's grace. God sent his grace down to man, just to a bunch of shepherds. That's God's grace right there. I mean, born of a nobody, Mary and Joseph. That's a picture also of God's grace. And think about this. Just like grace appeared to those shepherds, just like grace appeared to those shepherds, grace appears to us. God's grace. Sometimes people say, well, what about the people in the jungle? Have you ever heard somebody say that or think that? Or maybe you thought that. What about the people in the jungles that have never learned, never heard? And surely God wouldn't send them to hell. Well, Titus chapter 2, verse 11 says this. For the grace of God, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Now let me ask you, is God a liar? Obviously not. So the Bible then says the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. In one way or another, Romans 1, it's not in the notes, but Romans 1 talks about this, about the invisible things are seen. Clearly seen through creation. And I believe this with all my heart. If anybody's seeking, they're not going to go to hell. You see that in the Bible with Cornelius. Acts chapter 10, I mentioned him earlier. God said, go down to the seaside. Simon, there's somebody staying with Simon. His name is Peter. And he's going to show you what you need to do. And at the same time, Peter was having a vision about the sheep coming down. All the different manner of creatures. God says, kill and eat. He said, not so, Lord. I've never eaten anything that was uncommon. You know the story? How about that man, the Ethiopian eunuch? God never gave his name. But there he was, seeking God. He was in his chariot reading the Bible even. God sent Philip down there. Philip said to that eunuch, do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I? Except what? Some man should guide me. And the Bible says he went up into the chariot and preached unto him what? Man. That's a grace of God right there. I'm going to move along here, these last 2 points. Christmas is a time for glorifying God. Wow. This is convicting right here, this point. Really convicting. You know, the Bible says, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill towards men. Glory to God. Hey, let me ask you this, just real quick. Is your life still bringing glory to God? Not for your own self, but glory to God. And that's what our lives should do. And, you know, first, I'm skipping a little bit up there, Daryl. But you know, 1 Corinthians 10:31 says it so well. Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, it says here, do all to the glory of God. You know what, folks? This world needs to know that there's a reason for this season. The Bible says in the book of Psalms, we spend our years as a tale that is told. I used to preach that to the teenagers a lot when I was a youth pastor. We spend our years as a tale that is told. You know what? I'm writing a book. It's called The Book of Butch Wolverton. Guess who's reading it? Very visible book. And I do have a lot of private time, but I live a very public life. No? So do you. You're writing a book. We spend our years as a tale that is told. You know, I don't want to be one of these tales, one of these cautionary tales of a preacher gone bad, ran off of somebody or whatever. By the grace of God, that won't happen. It hasn't happened yet. I gotta say yet. By the grace of God, I won't. But many of you have read cautionary tales. I don't want to be a cautionary. I want to live my life in such a way, and I've done several funerals lately, and each person, I looked at the casket or the thing of ashes and thought to myself, what are people thinking about them? What am I thinking about them? Am I saying, wow, what a good life, or am I saying, oh, boy. We have a wonderful opportunity. Charles Dickens wrote a story about it. Ebenezer Scrooge. He was writing a terrible book. Terrible. But he got a second chance, and I know it's a fairy tale. But I like the principle behind it. He got a second chance, and he didn't mess it up. Hey, let me encourage you, friend. Don't mess up your second chance. Or your third chance. Your fourth chance. Get the picture. The just man falls down what? Let me ask you, how many times have you quit? you're still here. How many times have you quit your marriage, but you're still married? You know what I'm saying? I could go on and on. Hey, Christmas is a time for glorifying God. Let me ask you this. Is your life glorifying God? Now, don't get me wrong. I don't want to depress you here. None of us are perfect. I don't want to give you an excuse either, okay? But we're all sinners, folks. We're going to mess up. But as somebody once said, very wise person once said, it's not about the mess up. It's about the cover up. You know? We can look at King David. Oh, he messed up. Big time. And he did try to cover it up for a while. But ultimately, when God called his number, he said, you're right. You got right with God. King Saul, on the other hand, he denied till he died. Boy, that's, I know as a former youth pastor, boy, that was the theme of some people's lives. Deny till you die. You know, but let's not be that way. Let's not deny till we die. Christmas is a time for glorifying God. Folks, let's glorify God. Sometimes it's hard to do, in this day and age especially, when we're surrounded by so much bad news and so much negativity. But as much as we can, hey, Christmas is a time for glorifying God because people are reading our books. People are watching us. And then lastly, in closing, Christmas is a time for going home. You know, Mary and Joseph, they didn't live in Bethlehem. God brought him home. God has a way of bringing people home. And the Bible says, and Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem. Why? Because he was of the house and lineage of David. And we know the Bible says there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed, and everyone went to his own city. And, you know, Mary and Joseph went home. You know, there's a Christmas song written, I'll be home for Christmas. I like it. I got to say, I do like that song. I don't know who sings it. Those are the only words I know. But I'll be home for Christmas. You know, it's harder to go home nowadays with all the stuff going on in the world. They don't even want you to go home because of all the virus and everything. But Christmas is a time for going home. I'm reminded of the prodigal. He got away from home. The Bible says he went to a far city, far country, and there he wasted his substance on riotous living. But the Bible says something happened. One day he came to himself. Holy Spirit of God, conviction. Don't brush off conviction. We get so ornery and we get so out of sorts that we just brush off conviction. Let me encourage you. By my own experience, please. Don't brush off conviction. When is the last time you were convicted? I'll preach, that's your fault. You don't preach word messages. Convict me. I know where you're coming from. Forgive me for that. I'm not being sarcastic. But don't blame the preacher. Don't blame your wife. Spouse. Hey, preacher, people do that. Oh, yeah, you should sit in my office sometime. What we blame each other for. No, we're going to have to stand before God, folks. For our own selves. I've heard teenagers say to me, my parents, they're so fake. Man, I'm sick of it. And I've heard them gripe about their parents, and I tell them, hey, you know what? You got to answer for you. Your parents are going to have to answer for themselves one day. But young person, you're going to have to answer for you. And I say that to all of us. I say us this morning. We're all going to have to answer for us. It's me. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Christmas is a time for going home. That prodigal realized, you know what, man, I've been out here trying to find happiness, trying to find a good time. And now look, I've wasted it all. I'm not even worthy to be called your son anymore. But he went home, and he was surprised what he found. Hey, you need to go home. You that are watching video this morning, or will be watching it in the future, God wants you to go home. Wherever your home is, get to that place again. That place in your heart where you know God wants you to be, at home with the Lord. Ultimately, one of these days, we will go home. Jesus said in John 14:1, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, what? There ye may be also. One of these days, we're ultimately going to go home. And the Bible says we're going to give an account. Hebrews 9:27, it is appointed unto men once to die. But after this, what? Judgment. Let me ask you this. Those of you that are here, those of you that may watch, whenever you watch this, could be 2 years from now, I don't know. That's one thing good about technology. Where's your home, your eternal home? If you were to die right now, where's your home going to be? Heaven or hell? There's only two destinations, only two places. Jesus himself said, wide is the road that leads to destruction. And many are on that road, but narrow is the road that leads to life, and few there be that find it. Let me ask you, what road are you on? Every once in a while, I'm privileged to go home. Now, this is my home, don't get me wrong. That's the truth. I'm a Pennsylvanian now, from the top of my head to the bottom of my feet. I just don't root for Penn State, okay? But I am a Pennsylvanian. But every once in a while, I get to jump on Interstate 80 and head west. And I drive about 400 miles. And then I get to I-75. Actually, I think it's 280 that takes me to I-75. And then I take I-75 north. And then I got off of I-75. And I get up on Route 5. No, 275. 275 to Route 5. And then that takes me right home. And I do it every time. I drive by the church that I worked for 16 years. I do it every time. I drive by my one little house. Still has the rusted old basketball hoop there. And the shed that I built. And then I'll drive by my other house. And I don't do it for any kind of regret or any kind of wishful thinking. I remember that I'm writing a book. That was another chapter. But I'm writing a chapter today. And so are you. I'll be writing another chapter tomorrow. And it's soon to be 2021, and I'll be writing another chapter. One of these days they're going to find me dead. One of these days they're going to tell my family I'm gone. That they'll know. They'll have no doubt. And who I'm seeing. It's all because of this. That's why I can't quit. That's why I gotta keep going. Let me encourage you, that's why you can't quit. That's why you can't go. Gotta keep going. Why? Because you're writing a book. You're writing a book. And that's what Christmas is all about. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for the Holy Spirit. Speak. Convict. Gives comfort. Where would we be without the Father? Where would we be without the Son? Where would we be without the Holy Spirit? Where would we be without the real meaning of Christmas? Where would we be? We'd be lost. We'd be on our way to hell. Lord, there's so much bad around us, so much negativity. And if we're not careful, we'll live there. We'll live it. Help us to break free. Help us to have a fresh start in our mind, our heart. Lord, help us to do it. Encourage us to do it. Help us to be obedient to your Holy Spirit during this time, this opportunity to come and talk to you. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand to your feet, please.